Well, on this snowy but royal morning. Today, of course, is the day where Her Majesty the Queen celebrates her 70th year of reign. So we too celebrate it here in Wishaw Old, here in person, and if you're watching later, online. Let's just reflect upon Her Majesty and on those wonderful 70 years of her reign so far. Our call to worship this morning comes from Jeremiah chapter 1. The Lord said to me, I chose you before I gave you life, and before you were born I selected you to be a prophet to the nations. I answered, said Jeremiah, Sovereign Lord, I don't know how to speak. I am too young. But the Lord said to me, Do not say that you are too young, but go to the people I send you to and tell them everything I command you to say. Do not be afraid of them, for I will be with you to protect you. I, the Lord, have spoken. Then the Lord reached out, touched my lips and said to me, Listen, I am giving you words you must speak. Today I will give you authority over nations and kingdoms, to uproot and to pull down, to destroy and overthrow, to build and to plant. Let's join in singing our first hymn of praise this morning, 677, In the Name of Christ We Gather. Today. Lord, let us gather to meet you. Forgive us, Lord, when We do not recognize the presence that you have in our daily lives. When we push you away to the distant parts of the heavens and leave behind the closeness of our hearts. Bless us, Lord, as the light of love shines in the darkness of the days. Be a bolt that can shock us into action, to respond to the many tragedies of the world. Lord, we especially pray today for those in Afghanistan, for the sights of the babies and the children dying and suffering. For we are all of your children. We pray for those of our children in our church family, for those in our homes, in our neighborhoods, and those in our wider circle of life. For we are joined in a circle of birth, for you are our creator, and we are the created. May the rays of grace fall directly onto the trouble spots of the world. May we be able to see and experience a different picture of hope through the lens of your divine presence. A divine presence that provides food, shelter, medical supplies as part of our human covenant. Warm us, Lord, and provide us with that spiritual energy to come through the times of lostness, the times when we think it doesn't matter that we gather here Sunday by Sunday to celebrate you and worship you. Forgive us and uplift our feelings, the moments of the soul when we are weighed down by the burdens of life that crush the resilience we need. Lord, may the kindness, the generosity, and the thoughtfulness of thy nature be the spirit that feeds and teaches us in how we relate to one another. Be a friend, Lord, to each gathered in this place and to those who share our message online. Value our specialness. Challenge each one of us to be the disciples of Jesus in our street. Lord, in our service of worship today, may we follow thy words and thy thoughts and thy compassion as we travel along the road that believers have for thousands of years. We do so in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us in the Lord's Prayer to say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Today we're meeting on this special, special Sunday, and I thought to myself, what can I do on this special Sunday of 70 years of the Queen's reign? I thought, I haven't told a story for a while. And as you can see, I'm a little bit stiff today. So I thought, it'll give me another excuse to sit down while I'm conducting worship. I thought, what story could I tell you? Let me tell you the story of the Prince That Shines, who became a king who was humble. It was a winter's night. The snow was falling, not unlike it is outside today. Two woodcutters were in the middle of the forest. They looked up, and even though the snow was falling, there was bright stars in the sky. I'm sure one's about to fall to earth, said one of the woodcutters. And so they seemed to see this light coming through the sky, and it must be over there. The two woodcutters wandered through the darkness of the forest. And there they did not find a star, but there they found a cloak of gold. And inside the cloak of gold wasn't a star, it was a child, a young child. Who would leave their child? Did the child come from the sky? They couldn't believe that. But they called the child the prince, the star prince. Well, they took the child home to one of the woodcutter's wives. What have you brought here? We already have 5 children. How are we going to warn? How are we going to feed this child? It was a sign from God, I'm sure, said the woodcutter. God will feed us. Have no worry, woman. There will be enough food. Well, the prince, the star child, grew and grew. And that child had a light to its skin, a shininess to its skin. And blonde, curly hair. Let's look round here and see who's still got hair. The child grew. Beautiful child. A lovely child. Everyone admired that child. But as the child grew, it grew into a cruel child. A bit of a proud child. A little bit of a selfish child. And yet, because he was such a beautiful child, that star child, people followed him. And yet, he made fun of the poor children of the village. He wasn't very nice to the animals. Well, I tell you what he did. Don't ever do this. He poked sticks at the moles. When he caught little birds, he was pulling at their wings. He was a really, really not a very nice child, but very beautiful. The priest of the village said, young man, can I warn you? Do no harm. God has created all these creatures. Bring them no pain. Let me warn you. The star child continued to be cruel. And one day a beggar woman came to the village and he made fun of her. She wasn't very nice looking. He mocked her. She warned him, do not do that to people. The star child was playing. And one day, his father said, I think we've found your real mother. My real mother? He was so, so excited. He went back to the woodcutter's house. And there inside, who did he see but the old beggar woman who he had made fun of? You are not my mother. How could you be my mother? Look how good looking I am and how you look. You were stolen from me when you were a baby by robbers. And I know you are my child because you were wrapped in a golden cloak. He was very, very angry. You are so ugly as a toad and a snake. At that, the woman warned him once again, do not say these things, my son. And she left. The young man went outside. And although all the children of the village were in awe of the beautiful star child, they looked at him and their eyes grew and grew, for his face had fallen and he looked like a toad. His skin had come out all scaly and he looked like a snake. He could not believe it when he looked at his reflection in the river. Forgive me, God, he said. What must I do? And he went to the priest of the village. You must go and find that woman who is your mother and beg her forgiveness, and maybe you will change. And so the star child ran off and searched. He searched in the wood, he searched in the next village, he searched day after day after day. I must find her. He saw a mole, and he said, "Mole, have you seen my mother?" The mole looked at him. "You blinded me when I was young. I cannot see." He saw a little wren bird. "Can you fly over and see if you can find that woman?" "You clipped my wings when I was young, and I cannot fly high." He wandered and wandered, and all were afraid of him before the way he looked in his face and his skin. And one day he came upon a hare who was trapped. He untied the trap and let the hare free. "What can I give you?" said the hare. "I want to find my mother. Can you run fast and run faster than she is?" "I don't think so," said the hare. "But I do have something I can give you. You have saved my life." And so the hare went to his nest. And there the young man found an enormous piece of white, shining gold. "Take it," said the hare. "It has no use for me." And so the young man travelled on and came to the outskirts of the large town. And there he saw a man who was a leper, whose skin was as wrinkled, as crumpled as him. "Have you any food?" said the leper. "Can you feed me?" The young man only had the one piece of shining gold. And he thought for a moment and said, "Have this." "That is more riches than this entire town has," said the leper. "I only want a few coins." "No," he said, "take it all." And so the young man gave the leper all that he had. As he walked up to the palace gates of the town, the guards began to smile. The guards began to wave. Most people had run away for the last while at the way that he looked. "Look, our star child has returned," said the guards. The young man did not know what to think. "I am no star child." "Yes, you are. You must be the long-lost son of the king who was stolen as a child, who was so beautiful, and look at the way you look." The young man's face had changed. He had returned to his former looks. He no longer had the scales that caused him so much pain. "It is not me. I need to find my mother. And then he saw the old beggar woman. And he went to her and he said, "Mother." And he lay down before her and he wept. And his tears went on her feet. At that, the guard said, "Do you know who you are talking to?" The priests came and said, "You are fulfilling the prophecy. And that prophecy says that when the child returns, the king's leprosy will go and the queen will no longer wear the clothes of a beggar woman." And so it was that the star child was a prince. And the king said to him, "This is your mother, whose feet you have washed." And the queen said, "This is your father, who you have gave all your wealth." And so it was that the young man became a great king. And he ruled there. And he showed great mercy and showed great kindness. And all was given to the poor, and animals were protected. And there the star child became the star king and ruled the best in that kingdom forever and ever. And so God was praised, and he praised God. Let's give thanks today for the wonderful years of our own monarch. And let's think of the star child who became the star king. Let's sing now our young people's song, and we're going to sing it to a tape, and we're going to sing "The Spirit Lives to Set Us Free." Grateful to Erica of Sanctuary First for leading us in that song. Our younger ones are now going to leave us. Continue our series of looking at the nature of God through the pages of Scripture. And this week we're going to look at the prophet Jeremiah. We already heard in our call to worship that great call to that young man, Jeremiah. And he says, "I'm not worthy, Lord. I'm too young. I'm not worthy to have the words." And we hear of how the Spirit of God touched his lips. We're going to move on now. It's a very, very long book, but Angus is going to read from us some sections of chapter 36. Angus is going to read for us now from the book of Jeremiah.
Jeremiah 36, 4-10. So I called Baruch, son of Neriah, and dictated to him everything that the Lord had said to me. And Baruch wrote it all down on a scroll. Then I gave Baruch the following instructions. I am no longer allowed to go into the temple, but I want you to go in there the next time the people are fasting. You are to read the scroll aloud so that they will hear everything that the Lord has said to me and I have dictated to you. Do this where everyone can hear you, including the people of Judah who have come in from their towns. Perhaps they will pray to the Lord and turn from their evil ways, because the Lord has threatened this people with his terrible anger and fury. So Baruch read the Lord's words into the temple exactly as I had told him to do. In the 9th month of the 5th year that Joachim was king of Judah, the people fasted to gain the Lord's favor. The fast was kept by all who lived in Jerusalem and by all who came there from the towns of Judah. Then, while all the people were listening, Baruch read the scroll from the scroll everything that I had said. He did this in the temple from the room of Jeremiah, son of Shaphan, the court secretary. His room was in the upper court near the entrance of the new gate of the temple.
Join in singing now, and we sing a more traditional hymn. We're going to sing of the words of Isaiah in Dear Lord and Father of Mankind. We sing verses 1 to 3 and verse 6.
Second reading, Jeremiah 36, 20 to 23 and 27 to 29. The officials put the scroll in the room of Elishama, the court secretary, and went to the king's court, where they reported everything to the king. Then the king sent Jeduai to get the scroll. He took it from the room of Elishama and read it to the king and all the officials who were standing around him. It was winter, and the king was sitting in his winter palace in front of the fire. As soon as Jehoiada finished reading three of the four columns, the king cut them off with a small knife and threw them into the fire. He kept doing this until the entire scroll was burned up. After King Jehoiakim had burned the scroll that I had dictated to Baruch, the Lord told me to take another scroll and write on it everything that had been on the first one. The Lord told me to say to the king, "You have burned the scroll, and you have asked Jeremiah why he wrote that the king of Babylonia would come and destroy this land and kill its people and its animals." Amen. May God add his blessing to his readings of his holy word.
Thank you, Angus. And now may the meditations of my heart and the words of my mouth be acceptable to you, O Lord. Amen. What is the most difficult book you have ever read? What's the most difficult book you've ever read? Well, this week, the head of Waterstones praised a social media platform called BookTok, which is kind of like a TikTok for books, obviously, for encouraging younger people to trying to read James Joyce's Ulysses, which is 100 years old this week. Ulysses is an epic. It's described as, it's nearly 900 pages long, and it's trying to make the epic the ordinary. On the one hand, it's a very simple story about the day in the life of three people. Two men in Dublin, one is a Jew, and the other a woman, wandering the city. So that's its basic premise, and it leaves nothing out of life. The two men, one's called Stephen and the other is called Bloom, and they're both searching for paternity. One is searching for his father and the other is searching for his son. It's very episodic in nature, and I heard one person in the course of this week said, only read it in 20-minute bursts and you'll then understand it. Because it's very difficult to follow. Because although it's a story, it's not a story. It's not a story with a beginning, a middle, and an end. When I say it's about a day in the life of, it's about the different episodic thoughts of those people. And sometimes you can't tell in the book when it's inside their head and they're just dreaming and it's just fantasy. And other times, it's minor conversations. At other times, it's poetry. At other times, it's talking about life, death, and the universe, and everything. So what's its basic themes? Its basic themes of Ulysses. Stephen, the character, is remorseful. And he's remorseful that when his mother came to the end of her life, he didn't go to her bedside and pray with her. And he feels terribly guilty about this, and he wonders why he feels so much guilt. He's got a perception about life that somehow the sins of the past constitute the ethics that he has of the present. And there's religious motifs running throughout the entire book. And basically, it's about God. It's about God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And yet, a lot of people have said it's quite an atheistic book. The other motif is about Hamlet, is about Shakespeare, and about how the ghost of there represents life into art. And that's a very big theme in the book. But most commentators would say that the book is a warning. And it's described as the remorse of conscience. How's the warnings of our conscience catches up? Joyce wants us in real time to experience the characters. What's inside the characters? What's the feelings? What is their emotions? So it's nearly 900 pages, and yet if you ever go on BookTok or TikTok, it's a platform designed for you to make a 15-second video, or no longer than 5 minutes, and share. How can you describe something that's 900 pages about the life, the universe and everything, about the episodes of life in a day, and how can you capture that in 15 seconds? Whether it's TikTok or BookTok, we feel that we have to share the moment. In fact, I don't know why at the moment I'm not taking a selfie and putting it on a social media platform. Because is this moment in life that I'm sharing with you and you're sharing with me, is it worth capturing in order that what I experience, you experience? And so the juxtapose is that when you take a selfie or when you take a little video and you post it up, it's there. It's captured. And that was what Joyce was trying to do in his 900 pages. He was trying to capture a day in the life. Just as if I took a little video of myself now and posted it up on social media, I'm trying to capture how I feel at this moment, how I look, what I'm doing, and share it with people. Now, how does all that, a very, very long and complex book that's known as a modern classic, and this social media platform that many, many young people are doing, how does that relate to the Bible? The Bible is about sharing the story of God. Okay? So there are 39 books of the Old Testament, and it's all about the history, the songs and the psalms. It's about laments. It's got poetry. It's got prophetic visions. It's got warnings. There's all those 39 books. But there's not only 39 books. There's another 26 books of the New Testament. And so we know that in the Gospels, we read of Jesus' life and of his teachings. And then we go to the Acts of the Apostles, where we hear the history of the early church. And then we have Paul's letters and warning what went wrong in the early church and God trying to teach us to keep on the right path. And then there's the visions in the book of Hebrews, or the very complicated visionary book of Revelation. And then you get little vignettes. You get Jude or Philemon, just very short one-chapter books. And so that complexity of sharing the experience, the story of God in 66 books, which takes a lifetime to read and understand, and how can we convey this to the TikTok generation that wants to experience life in 5 minutes? And I found that lovely slide, can you name the books of the Bible in 5 minutes? And there's various little videos that try and teach you just to remember the names. So how does that connect to our own lives? James Joyce tried to explain life in a day through three characters. If you go on TikTok, it tries to explain life through little short clips and videos. We know that life is both a journey from our birth through our teenage years to our early years to our mid years to our more mature years. And yet we know it's kind of like Joyce's books. It's episodic. You're here for an hour, and then you move on to the next part of your day, and then the next part of your day, and the next part of your day. And that's not really a journey, is it? It's just a day. And so God's prophets were trying to make sense of the meaning and the message of God. And they were trying to make sense and experience it and help us experience it when the community is lost or when the individual needs redemption. And each Bible story, each incident in the Bible that I'm going to unpack for us today is about the nature of God. Over the last four Sundays, we've been looking at how can we understand the nature of God in our lives today? How can we make and understand and experience it? Do we experience God's presence through warning? I'm not going to reread the call to worship today. The call to worship was about God saying to a young man, I'm going to put my words on your lips so that you can warn an entire nation. The story about the star child is about the warning to when we are not kind to others. Because God is kind to us. It is about God's care for us. And God says to us these significant words. I knew you before I formed you in your mother's womb. Before you were born, I set you apart and appointed that you are my prophet to the nation. Before we were formed in the womb, God knows us. And so we have the prophet Jeremiah. And the prophet Jeremiah is known as the weeping prophet. And he weaves both his personal experiences throughout the book of Jeremiah, of Kings, and of Lamentations. So, hey, I'm going to tell you about three books of the Bible in 10 minutes. No, I'm not. I'm going to say that here is one man whose personal experiences, he is imprisoned, he is called by God, throughout a 40-year history. And he weaves his own experiences through the experiences of his people. And he tries to say to both a group of people and to individuals, you are special to God. And why are you special? Because God warns you of the things that are going wrong in your culture, as a people, in your religion. When things are not good, I'm going to warn you. I'm going to say, be more faithful. If we don't respond to God, it ends badly. And so the book of Jeremiah is as complex as the book of Ulysses. Jeremiah is a mixture of poetry and prose, of laments, of things called acted parables, and we're going to look at one of them in a minute. It's a biography. It's a history. His life weaving in with the relationship of God and God's relationship with us. And just like the book of Ulysses, the book of Jeremiah is trying to see how our past experience shapes our relationship with God and how we can see God's nature. And what is it about God's nature that Jeremiah wants to say to us amidst all the complexities of that 40-year life? He wants to point the finger at us and say, you are special to God. God cares about you and your experiences. So how does he do that in the story that Angus shared for us today? The context is 40 years of history of a prophet who became a persecuted prophet. A persecuted small nation. I looked for various different maps that could convey Judah's position as a small nation. It's like the south of modern-day Israel. And Judah was a tiny nation caught amidst a big geopolitical war. The failing empire of Assyria. The rise of Babylonia. The interference of the Egyptians for a short time during that 40 years. I'd like you to think, how does that relate to modern life? Think of the tiny nation of Ukraine. There's Russia, there's America, there's the EU, and little Ukraine is caught in the middle. And so if we go back thousands of years to the time of Judah, kings of Judah came and went. Whatever side of the empire the king supported, then it survived. we have King Josiah, who was the good law reformer. He did a great job. And then there's Nebuchadnezzar. You'll know that name. Nebuchadnezzar was the king, the emperor of Babylonia, a vain man with statues, golden statues named after him. And then, as Angus told him, told us, it wasn't King Josiah was the story in, at the end of Jeremiah. It was his son Joachim who was weak. Now, that's all history, and I could spend the next 45 minutes giving you the history of that. The relevance of it is we live in a time when there's still geopolitical issues. You have the tiny nation in the middle, Ukraine. And when I wrote this sermon at the beginning of the week, I thought, are we going to have a war by the end of the week? Is it going to be as relevant as that? And if you think that doesn't matter, well, our energy prices will matter to us. Who's the good lawmaker in that story? Who is the vain person on that picture? Who was the weak one? The Ukrainian President Zelensky was at one time a TV actor, and he's caught up in the maelstrom of these political power plays. The final calamity for the people of Judah was that a large part of the population for over 100 years was sent into exile in Babylonia. And we hear about that in the story of the Jewish people. Already you can see from that map, Ukraine, Crimea was annexed in 2014. There's been a quasi-war in Donetsk for now 2-3 years. That's on the eastern side of Ukraine. That's 40 years of history on that slide since the Ukraine separated from the old Soviet Union. Now, there's analogies, there's parallels that I've tried to make with modern times in the geopolitical situation. And some are relevant and others are not. The point to make, though, is there's warning signs. And often the warning signs come too late. If something happens in Ukraine, there will be millions of people come into Western Europe as exiles. So it will affect us as well as them. And so throughout the Old Testament prophets give a warning. And they give a warning in advance. Now, our culture cannot take warnings. We as a people, we cannot take a minister standing up in a pulpit and wagging the finger and saying we're all sinners and we're all doomed and we're all going to hell in a handcart. Those days, hundreds of years ago, when the ministers and the priests acted as moral arbiters for the nation and the culture, they are gone. Nobody but nobody will take somebody wagging a finger and saying, God's warning you. People won't flock to church if you give them that message. They want a funny story. They don't want a warning. And yet, the prophets were there to warn. They weren't there to correct. They weren't there to wag the finger. They were there to point the finger and say, you are the people of God and you are special to God. And that's why God cares so much that he put the words on the lips of a young man to come and warn his people for 40 years. And so we hear the story of Jeremiah eventually in chapter 36. A lot has happened to Jeremiah during that time. And Jeremiah's story is chaotic. The book of Jeremiah isn't a timeline from beginning to middle to end. So that's why it's like the book of Ulysses. Bits of Jeremiah don't really make sense because they're all edited together. But here we have a story where Jeremiah has been banned from the temple. Jeremiah can't come to church. He can't preach to the people. He's the major, major prophet of that nation. And yet he's banned. He can't come and tell the people that God cares about them and loves them. And so he writes it down on a scroll. And his editor, Baruch, can go to the temple. And there he reads the words of Jeremiah, just as Angus read the words of Jeremiah for us today. The officials were worried. Would the people rise up? Would there be a revolution? Would the people turn against this weak king, this new king, caught, remember, in the maelstrom of the geopolitical? Did he support Egypt? Did he support the old Assyrians? Did he support Babylonia? So they take the message right to the king. And as Angus told us, and well done, Angus, for reading all those complicated words, he takes it to the king, and the bit of the story that we've got to remember is the king takes it, and he takes it out, and it's such a detailed story, he takes a penknife, and he slices it up with a penknife, and then he burns it, because it's wintertime, and they're standing round an open fire. So what happens after God's word through Jeremiah has been burnt? Jeremiah writes another scroll, exactly the same thing, but adding a bit extra. Take another scroll, write the words, and all the words that were on the first scroll, which Jehoiakim, king of Judah, burned up. And that's the bit we hear at the end of our little story. So the vision of the story is just in that tiny, tiny bit. Can we make sense for the TikTok generation? Yes. Because it's all about destroying the scroll, the word of God. When people heard that story for the first time, do you think they remembered all the characters that were described in it? All the court officials and the name of the king and all that? No. Do you think they understood the theology behind it and the 40 years and Jeremiah and the personal experience and all the stuff I've told you? No. What would they latch on to? They would latch on to that visual image of a scroll being burnt. A 15-second video of thousands of years ago. And that 15-second video would say God's word, God's prophet, was being ignored, rubbished, and dismissed. And that visual image of the scroll being burnt, that little episode would have stuck in the mind. And I bet you, at the end of this, sermon, you won't remember anything about Joyce or about Stephen or about Bloom, but you will probably remember the bit when the scroll was burnt, when God's word was not there. It's burnt up. And yet, as we hear in the story, the prophet then writes it again. And that's why thousands of years later, we tell the story again. That's why thousands of years later, we tell of the warning of the prophet of God to us today, amidst the maelstrom of a geopolitical situation. And so we have Joyce's epic story, reflecting the episodic nature of life, that it is a journey, but it's not a beginning and a middle and an end. You're not going to go out of here. Somebody watching here is not going to be changed by that. We're caught in the geopolitical maelstrom of the Ukraine. There might be a war at the end of next week. We hope that there is not. But history warns us that little nations are bullied around by empires. And at times, God's message is a difficult message. God's message is a challenging message. God's message is a desire for a return, for us to return to faithfulness with God, to be more trusting, to be more loving, to be like the little story in our all-age worship where the young man realized what it was in humility. And the story, based on one of Oscar Wilde's story, is the hope that the monarch, the government is kind and caring, is listening for God in life. But Jeremiah doesn't leave us there. Jeremiah gives us probably the three most significant verses in the whole of the Old Testament. And Jeremiah gives us what God wants to give us from the Old Testament, from those 39 books, into the New Testament. There has to be a link. And here are the words in the King James Version. "But this shall be the covenant that I make with the house of Israel. After those days, saith the Lord, I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts. And I will be their God, and they shall be my people." Jeremiah was saying to his people amidst the maelstrom of all those things that I've outlined in today's address, that God has a covenant relationship with us. And that is a covenant relationship of love. And the covenant relationship the Jews believed was written on the tablets of stone of the Ten Commandments. And that's why the temple was so special, the Ark of the Covenant was so special. But here is Jeremiah saying, it's going to be written differently. Because it's not going to be written in tablets of stone. It will be written in your heart. And what will that do? By the fact that God's law of love is written in our heart, it means that our inner spirit, the King James Version calls it our inward parts. That's our soul. That's our love. That's the bit inside us that makes us good people, but determines our conduct with one another. And then he goes on to warn about the temple religion and the false worship. The stubbornness of the evil heart, he says. But the notion that the covenant is written on our hearts, and then there will be a new covenant. And that's next month's sermons. Because the new covenant, as we know, was Jesus Christ. After Jeremiah and after the prophets, there was a long time when there was no books of the Bible written. It was a few hundred years. Did God abandon his people for a few hundred years? No, he gave them those messages, those warnings. And then they found a child, not a child found with a golden cloak in a forest, but a child found in a stable. And that new covenant was Jesus. And during the month of February, we'll look at what that new covenant means for us. Amen. And may God bless to us the story of Jeremiah and the burning of the scroll.
Let us pray. Loving and gracious God, we come before you to pray for our world, a world in which there is so much suffering and pain, violence and hurt. We often wonder how we can change things in this world. Help us to make a difference that the world may be a better place for all. We come to you to pray for the church. We are still in the midst of a pandemic and people need hope more than ever. Help us to share that much needed hope with others. We ask too for your guidance as we continue to respond to the pandemic. Help your church to share your gospel with the world. We come before you to pray for those going through a difficult time at the moment. We bring the names of those we know who are in need of our prayers, lifting them up to you. We think of those in hospital, those for whom it is a difficult time at the moment. We with all who needs our prayers right now, those we know and those we don't, may they know your love. We place into your loving arms those whom we have lost, knowing that you welcome them home. May they now be at peace. Comfort the bereaved, and may they know your peace. Love and strength as they face the days ahead without those whom they have lost. We pray for ourselves, Lord. You call us each and every one every day to serve you. Equip us for the task to which you call us. Help us to fulfill our calling and bring about your kingdom. You know the challenges that each and every one of us face. We ask that you will guide us through each day and every challenge that we face. As we enter into a new week, we go knowing that you are with us every step of the way. We ask these things and all our prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Saviour. Amen.
Thank you, Billy. And now our offering shall be received. Understand that the session clerk is on other duties today, but I invite Liz to share our intimations today.
Good morning and welcome to our service. Whether you're here in person, watching online, or listening on the telephone later today, I do hope we all experience a blessing from this shared fellowship, even at a distance. Please take time following our service to share in socially distanced fellowship over tea and coffee in the hall following service. Our thanks today to Keith for leading our worship, and to Angus for his reading, and Billy for leading our prayer, and to the production team of May, Neil and Billy for preparation, editing and production of the finished product. The speaker at the Men's Club tomorrow evening will be Lang Stewart, who will give a slide presentation on exotic birds. Everyone is welcome to share in that meeting. While we're all delighted that the steps taken so far to limit the spread of the virus have been successful, leading to relaxation of the guidance, there is still a long way to go. Current guidance is, before we meet with anyone out with our household, we should undertake a lateral flow test. However, I do have to say that we have exhausted our supply of lateral flow tests, but are hopeful of getting more in the not too distant future. I am pleased to report that Tom Ferrier is recovering at home following a spell in hospital. Jean Anderson is now back home after a spell in hospital. And Tom Houston is recovering well after his operation. On the downside, Colin Russell is self-isolating at home. We send our best wishes and prayers to all who are ill at home or in hospital. At the close of the service, could I remind you of the usual hygiene rules? Please leave the sanctuary starting at the rear and as directed by the door duty elders, although you usually all just make your own way there. Any used face coverings should be placed in the bins provided. Please remember to use the hand sanitizer. Maintain a reasonable distance apart, even when chatting outside after the service. And to anyone, stay calm, stay safe, stay praying, and God bless you all.
Thank you so much, Liz. And we just add, don't slip on the ice as you're going out, or slip down the steps. And that goes for all of us. Thank you to May for playing for us this morning, and she's going to lead us now into hymn 738. We're going to close with Glorious Things of Thee Are Spoken. Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.